Hi. Tonight we're going to do a show about family. So I thought I'd bring on my husband, because it's relevant to the theme. This is Ed. And Ed's actually the director of the show. So do you want to say anything? Or?
No, thanks.
No, okay. Wait, can I just clear up something here? I don't want you to think because he's the director and I slept with him, that's how I got the job. Okay? I got the job because of my talent.
Could I say something?
No. So anyway, the reason I brought him out here is because the show's about family, and this is just to show how different people can be in a relationship. See the diversity you can have within a couple. Because a lot of people wonder how we actually have three children. Because it doesn't match up. I mean, you don't really need a map of the anatomy to... So if any of you watching at home would like to maybe think about that and then write your answer, how we have the three children, on a postcard, send it back to the BBC, that would be fine. I'll just give you a clue. We do incorporate a trampoline and a very intricate pulley system. Okay, so that's all I wanted to say. Just, you know, by seeing us, everything is possible in a family. Okay, that's all I want. So you can go back and direct now. Ed, bye. Ed, bye. Not just his legs that are long. No. So this week the theme is family, and that's because somebody said this is the year of the family, so now we know. And the BBC have just crammed on the air shows about families in crisis. Have you seen these shows? I mean, who isn't in crisis? I'm in crisis. Everybody's in crisis. I mean, 2,000 years ago they were in crisis. But they didn't have those family in crisis hotlines that you hear about, you know, where you call up and you bitch to Esther Ranson. But, you know, there was an original idea for having the family. I mean, there was the original reason for the family unit was to protect us from the environment. And that was in prehistoric times, and that's a fact. So that if there was an earthquake, you would just smush your second cousin into the cracks. It's true. That is a true story. I know in my home, my mother used to walk around with an axe. But I won't go into that because we'll be here all night. And then they'll eventually have to put me in a muzzle. But she has passed this information on to me. And I mean, I don't know what I'm doing. Because I sit around with my children, you know, and we're at home. And we're all watching how long it takes the ketchup to drip onto the floor. And then we squash some Play-Doh up the cat's nose. And we all go, ooh, 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 are we going to get in trouble when our mommy comes home? And then I realize with horror, I am the mommy. My point about tonight is that there are lots of different ways of living in a family. Lots of different ways of being a family. I mean, it doesn't always have to be mommy, daddy, 2.4 kids. What do you think 0.4 kids looks like? I always wanted to know. I mean, what is that? Just a couple nostrils and a thumb? But our whole audience tonight is brimming with other possibilities for a family unit. Thousands of different alternatives. Now, look, I'm not saying this is right. I'm not saying this is wrong. But these are just other samples of human life. So, you know, to throw the net a little further, don't be afraid. Look at you. Don't be afraid. See, Oprah, you don't have to make $2 million a year to hold a mic. I can do that. You work with this. Oh, I'm supposed to have it for you. You came actually from a home with a husband and had 7.11 children or something outrageous.
Seven.
You were very fertile, weren't you?
Oh, very.
You? Very fertile. And then you left the husband.
Yes.
Yes. And, you know, so
I think
you
had enough.
He had enough, right. Too many children, or what was the thing with you? What did
he just thought that our relationship was very platonic. And he came home, he went to work one day, and he said, when I come home tonight, I'm going to take you out. I'm going to take you somewhere special, so get a babysitter. It's very difficult to get a babysitter for that many children, I tell you.
And he took me to... Good
sheep. He took me to a gay pub.
Right.
He said, I'll have one drink and I'll leave you there. And then I'll come back for you at 11. So he did.
So he figured out that probably you were not.
Yeah, it was great.
Really? So that was the end of you?
Not a weight off my shoulders, it was.
So you, in one swift evening, became...
I became myself.
Right. And now you're with, what's your name?
Ellie.
And this is the new family.
Yes.
Does this make you feel more comfortable as a family than the last one did, even though the last one looked like the kind of ideal home and garden?
Yeah, this is much more comfortable.
Do you want to have biological children with this woman?
No, thank you.
No. be the benefit.
I don't want any more nappies.
No, it must be the benefit of being with a woman, is it?
The benefit's being that you don't have to worry about when you're having sex about getting pregnant, because right. I really worried about that a lot.
Children, don't try this at home. I've been thrown off the television.
Sorry about that.
What's another benefit then?
Well, you know each other. We have the same things, PMS.
Oh, the house must be like an air raid siren.
It is, yeah. Yeah, we understand one another, you know, right. We do. We're both women. Your children need male influence as well. I mean, especially if you've got boys. I've got 4 boys and 3 girls. And they need that male influence still. So there were men that were important in our life.
Right.
The godfathers to the children. And her brothers.
Right. So you know that you need a drop of male, so you just bring in male.
They think they're lucky because they've got 2 mums that love them.
Thank you very much. Okay. We have a really different situation. They're married, and one of them is the wife, and one of them is the husband. Okay, which one is which? You're the wife.
I know that.
Don't. I know that. And you're the husband.
That's right.
Yes. And you're Joanna.
Yes.
And you're Nomi.
Nomi.
Right. Uh-huh. When you met, were you in like butch clothing?
I was dressed as a girl, yes.
You were what?
Dressed as a normal girl,
right.
Yeah.
And then were you scared when you'd break it to her that she'd get up and go?
I was a little nervous.
Yeah.
She can't possibly say that. Right. We'd known each other 3 days, and she said, can I borrow your nightdress? You can't really be frightened, can you?
And did you think that was sort of thrilling?
I was surprised.
Yeah.
I was also very honoured, because that was a lot of trust, so I decided, he'll do.
Is it a horrible thing to first say to somebody, I actually want to put a nightie on?
It wasn't to this lady.
Yeah.
And that's how I knew she was special, and the one for me.
And did you both wear wedding gowns? I need to know.
I have one wedding dress that I got married in. She has loads.
Oh, no.
She collects.
Wow. But you married as a guy.
In an right. ordinary straight man.
And then, if you're both like in the clothes, right, how do you divide up the work? I mean, are you really female, or you're male, but you just like the dresses?
Oh, I go out to work, and she does all the housework.
What's the difference if you're, two ladies at home? What's it, is there any difference or no?
In private at home, we're husband and wife, although we both dress and look like women.
Right.
Although we've often got no hair on at home.
But in public.
Where's the hair room? Oh, she's got her hair. And this is your hair?
No. This
You're
is
both
a wig
in wigs,
too.
So yeah. You both walk around bald?
Uh-huh.
No.
Uh-huh.
Oh, I'm glad you got dressed up
it's
for tonight.
It's much cooler.
Much cooler, yeah.
But in public, we're just 2 sisters, because a lot of people might be offended if I treated her as my husband when we're out.
Right.
So we're 2 sisters.
And does she make you feel like it's your girlfriend, or does it kind of arouse you? I mean, do you find it sort of sexy, too? Be honest.
Well.
It's only television. No, I mean...
I find it very sexy.
Okay.
I can't stand men in nightwear, but women, well,
really?
Her is really nice.
And when you were a little girl, did you ever think, oh, well, I like men, but I like him a little less threatening?
I don't think so, no. I don't think I realized until I met this
But
person.
It's more of a kick when she's in a nightdress. Really? We'll talk later. Thank you. We'll talk later. Thank you. We actually have a commune here where there's 50 people who live together. Is that right?
That's right, yeah.
50, and there's 20 kids?
Yeah.
30 kids?
20 kids.
And how many mommies and daddies?
About 20 mommies.
20 mommies. 20 mommies, 20 daddies?
Fewer daddies.
Right. So that everybody, are you a child of this commune?
Yeah.
And did you always like relate to one mommy, or did you relate to, different women being good for different things as a mommy?
Well, when I first moved there, I just related to my own mother, but as I got to new people over a longer period, then I'd go to them for help or advice.
And is it all kind of that you all sort of, nobody's kid is their property, that you kind of grab a handful of kids and go off? Is that the sensation? Do you feel like everybody's your sister and brother?
Yeah, most people.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Is that nice?
Yeah, it is. It's a good way to grow up. And
do you feel healthier from coming out of this?
Yeah, I
think. Do you?
Yeah.
Yeah, do you feel like you have like different mothers reacting?
I think I've got...
How many?
20 mummies.
Really? So do you go to different ones for different things, like
yep.
I was asking him?
Yeah, I go to different people for different things.
Well, like what?
I don't know.
Well, like, does one tell you about the birds and the bees, and another one tells you about, stealing, and another one? Yeah?
Yeah.
So maybe your mommy doesn't specialize in some of these areas.
Yeah.
Are you one of these mommies? Your mommy.
Yes.
So do you get peeved when she goes off to somebody else and says, actually, this is not specialty, so she says, I'm getting a better mother for this one.
No, I'm pleased.
You are pleased?
Because oh, that's generous. Other kids might come to me.
Well, so it all kind of swaps around, yeah. Like a recycling kind of thing.
Oh, you've got it.
That's fantastic. What's yeah. then, is it odd in the real world that, you know, you just see us all living isolated?
I think so.
It is.
Yeah.
So do you feel sorry when you see?
Yeah.
You think we're unnatural?
Yeah.
Okay, thank you very much. Okay, well, what have we got here? You're a single mother.
Yes.
And you wanted a baby.
Yeah.
Right. So you didn't want a relationship. You didn't. You were not looking for the hubby to walk down the aisle with. Right? So you just said, I'm going to get some... Whatever. What can we call it on television? Well, what males provide? But
well, I was looking for a sperm donor.
A sperm donor. Let's be mature. So how'd you go about finding me?
I was just driving around where I lived and just looking out for like good-looking blokes. And I saw one, asked him.
And he jumped out of the car?
Yeah, I just stopped the car. And I was wearing my work clothes. I was covered in paint. I ran up to him and said, would you like to be a sperm donor? And he just looked at me like, huh? I don't know what you're talking about. So I spoke about it a bit more. And I think I totally freaked him out when I explained I was a lesbian and wanted a baby. So that was the end of him.
Yeah.
Same thing happened to the second bloke. And then the third bloke, I had to actually sleep with him.
Right.
Yeah. So
did you know what to do?
I'd not slept with a bloke for years and years. Yeah. I'd only done it three times anyway, so I was a bit nervous. So I got hold of the bloke when it was a good time, dragged him around the house, and dragged him upstairs. I thought, oh, well, no wasting time, get him upstairs. And he was really, really shy. He just sat on the edge of the bed and just was, like, talking over his shoulder, looking at me. I thought, well, he's not going to make a move. I thought, but he's a straight man and I'm a lesbian and I'm going to have to do the work. So basically, I just got him in the bed, had sex with him and...
you said you just prodded him.
Yeah, he's a bodybuilder and he's got a really good body and he's really nice looking. And then I was like poking him and prodding him, thinking,
and
it's so
worked.
Different from a woman. Well, it worked. Didn't
you
work
learned so
time.
Much on this show.
It didn't work the first time. I was a bit disappointed, so I had another go. Well, didn't work the second time, but it luckily worked the third time, so that was okay. So third time lucky and I got my little daughter.
And so you're the mommy and the daddy?
Well, no, not really. I don't even try and take on the role of mummy. I just sort of like
you're
do what
just
comes naturally.
This girl. Yeah.
Yeah, I just care for her and love her
That's
and give her
healthy.
Everything she wants.
Thank you. My next guest is Tammy Faye Bakker, who's been described as the Felicity Kendall of the Bible Belt, meaning she's perfect. She's not a hooker. Again, the image was this ideal couple preaching goodness to their flock on television. About 20 million viewers a night worth of flock. I mean, they talked about goodness, and they talked about heaven, and they talked about the family, and how important the family was, and how important it is to keep together. He's been jailed, they're divorced, there was sex, violence, drug, embezzlement, blackmail, it's a mess. Now we're gonna show you a little foreplay of what their life was all about. Roll the film.
It was the 80s, the decade of prosperity, and Tammy Faye had it all. In the eyes of the world, she had a fairy tale marriage to televangelist Jim Bakker, and together they created PTL, the largest television ministry in the world. They broadcast from their religious theme park, Heritage USA, to over 50 nations. Then, in 1987, their giant empire started to crumble. First, Jim's scandalous affair with Jessica Hahn became public. But the humiliation didn't end there. Jim was charged and convicted of 24 counts of fraud and conspiracy involving over $100 million of PTL's money. The papers were full of Jim and Tammy's extravagant lifestyle that included mink coats and diamond rings for Tammy and even an air-conditioned kennel for their dog. Jim was sentenced to 45 years in prison. Tammy Faye was left devastated and alone.
Tammy Faye was conveniently placed in Palm Springs, so I had to go visit her.
I can hear Tammy's dulcet tones.
Well, oh, you're not... There she is.
There's a little lady.
It's nice to see you.
Do you mind us filming?
Not at all.
Look at you. I'm taller than somebody.
Well, when I take my shoes off, you're really tall.
You know, I can carry you over the threshold, Tammy. That's
I want nice. Exactly the same makeup as you, Yvonne, because I've been in the mirror this morning for about 3.5
yes.
hours. And
okay.
Suddenly I'm naked.
I'll do you.
All right.
I'll do you.
All right.
Exactly. I'll do you up like Tammy Faye, okay?
I love these shag pies.
Aren't shags fun?
I love shags. You see, we don't have this in England. Do you get this? Do you understand? We don't have, they just discovered rugs. What are your other beauty secrets?
Get our glue.
Bold hold.
Bold hold is wonderful.
Is this how you keep the hair in this?
Yes.
Doesn't move, does it, Tammy?
It don't move.
It don't move.
Do you sleep with your makeup on?
No, but I sleep with my eyelashes on. I don't take them off unless one comes off, and then I just replace it.
God.
So let's get a chair.
Does your husband sometimes come through with like a crop shearer thing and try to cut his way?
No,
he loves it.
He loves my eyelashes. He said when I, and you're not going to believe this, but he said when I look at Tammy, I don't see makeup. I just see a nice person, and I think that's awful nice.
Oh, that's nice.
This is what I use for my cheeks. This is called desert dust. And one...
Such a natural color, Tammy.
Desert dust, yes. What it does is one color fits everybody. It's
even if you're a black person.
Yeah, it does. It really does. It goes on everybody.
What color are you underneath this?
Underneath this? Very brown. Right. Because I have a tan.
Right.
So I'm really brown underneath here. And then I just, I use this little bit of pink.
Oh, a right very here. Subtle pink here.
Very subtle
Look
pink.
Look at this color, that Tammy.
I know, is that wild like or what? The English are going to faint when they see the pink. But the secret to eyelashes is just literally having the black glue, and you just put a little teeny bit on it, just like that.
Right.
Like so.
How often do you put
I've
them on
put
yourself?
I've never put them on somebody else in my whole life, so we'll just give this a try.
Just try to get it near my
there you
eye,
go.
Tammy.
Okay, we got it.
Now, do I have to keep my eyes shut?
No. Just when I do it.
So you put them on, like, once a month or something
on
yourself?
Yeah, about. Or if I need to replace one once in a while, I'll replace
I mean, when you get up from the pillow, are their lashes
no,
long there?
No, never. That's just some magazine has written up. Good.
Because you wrote that book, Christian Wives, where you said you don't have to be dowdy if you're a
no,
Christian.
No, that's right.
Right?
I believe that.
In the book, do you talk about being sexy for your husband?
Yes, and I think you ought to be sexy for your husband. I think your husband's probably the only one you really ought to be sexy for.
And how do you be, I mean, how are
well,
you
Well, you know, you try not to look dowdy all the time. Right. You know, that's another way to do it. You dress for him. Right. I dress for Ro, and I think that's nice. He likes
So he said, Tammy, I want you to have these earrings.
Yeah, well, you know, he just says what he likes. If he says he really likes something, that's what I wear. If he says he doesn't like something, I steer clear of that.
Right.
You know. But then, too, I have my own personality. He always tells me, I like the way you put yourself together. You are really looking sexy.
Really?
Yes, just really looking sexy. Now, let me push him up here so
right.
they don't...
I think you've glued my lids together.
No, I haven't.
Were you real poor, you know, like in those Southern songs?
We were poor.
I mean,
had
like...
an outdoor bathroom. And a pump outside to pump the water.
I know. Yeah, I've seen the movies.
Yes, yeah. And you
Sissy
you,
Spacek always plays people like you. Anyway, so then you and Jim got married.
Yes.
And then you started going around, what was it like?
In ministry.
Right. Mm-hmm. And were you preaching or was he preaching?
No, he was preaching. I was singing.
Right.
And that's when the puppets were introduced, when Susie and Ellie were introduced.
This is a puppet, by the way.
A
the
puppet.
Jim and Tammy show started off, their first success was with a puppet.
Yes.
And this is how they found the puppet.
Yes. We were in a drugstore, and I saw a Soaky Bubble Bath, and Soaky Bubble Bath was about that big. Had a little Porky Pig head on it. It was about that big of a head with little perky ears. And I said, I can make a little girl out of that, and we can do a puppet.
You are a genius.
And then I found out I had a Susie Moppet voice. And the Susie Moppet voice is something like this. And then we decided that Susie said to me, Tammy, I need a friend. And I said, well, what kind of a friend would you like?
The puppet spoke
to me. The puppet spoke to me.
When it's not Jesus, it's a puppet.
I need a friend. And I said, what kind of friend do you need? She seemed real to me.
Even though it was me doing it, she was real to me.
Just like a real
and
person.
And Susie made an album and sold thousands. And she had a little singing voice, and she'd sing her little song, Jesus takes a frown and turns it upside down, and oops. There comes a smile. I wrote that one. When I'm very sad, Jesus makes me glad. And oops, there comes a smile.
And
Allie
million.
Would sing, and Allie would sing, when you are downhearted and don't know what to do, take it away, Sus. Then the love of Jesus comes a-shining through. Get it, Allie.
Jesus takes a frown and turns it upside down, and oops,
there comes a smile.
You know, if I didn't believe in Jesus before, I do now. I'm filled with him. I do. I believe in him now.
You know he's up there.
I do.
He's up there looking at
you. And in your voice. And then you had 20 million viewers,
yes.
And everybody in America was screaming and crying and sending so much money. And in 1986, they made $129 million.
Yes. Yes.
But the rest of the world, we're getting really peeved because you were spending a lot of cash.
Right.
So, I mean, you never felt like, ooh, maybe I shouldn't do this? I mean, you came from a poor background, and you know what this does to poor people.
I still bargain hunted. I mean, I still shot.
Got that cheap pool.
I did. I still
had a yacht with the hole in it.
No, we didn't have a yacht.
No, but you know, they said you had like, you should have stayed with humble cars or at least, you know, hit it.
The Bible says that I would that you would prosper even as your soul prospereth. That's God's word. And he wants Christians to prosper and to be in good health. And Christians do not have to be poor.
Right.
They don't have to be poor.
Did you ever think, maybe we shouldn't show people that we have,
poor
or anything?
No, I never did, because I don't believe in being a hypocrite.
Maybe we shouldn't show the public what we're living on?
No, never.
And you didn't think,
I didn't think anything of it. That was the way we lived, and so I didn't think anything of it. You know, that's the way they all live. Jimmy Swaggart lives that way. Oral Roberts lives that way. The whole nation lives that way.
All those evangelists get that stuff.
Everybody, so I just didn't think anything of it. I didn't think it was...
It's weird, though,
any different.
Because you always, when I was a little kid, you know, you always saw preachers were supposed to be poor.
And
so
that's not true, though.
I know.
That is not true.
Well, you changed those laws. You changed those laws around. What was the most you had? You know, what was the point when you were like, I'll tell you.
No, we had a limo, but our limo picked up guests. Jim and I, we both had a Mercedes.
Yeah.
And our Mercedes were rented. They were not bought.
Right.
They were rented, but we were still both driving one. And at that point... I believe that I thought, I don't need this.
So what'd you do, sell the other Mercedes or give it away?
Well, that it was right at that point that we lost PTL, so we never had a chance to do anything about it.
Coincidence,
you know?
This is good.
Yeah.
God said, no, you won't have that Mercedes, and they took it away.
There's nothing wrong. There's nothing wrong with having those things. But when those things have you, that's when it becomes wrong.
Okay, where's the coffee cups? After PTL, which was Praise the Lord, congregation, right? Then you went on and you made this thing called, or you didn't, but Jim and you did, made this thing called Heritage USA, which was, tell them.
Heritage USA was like a city. It was like a city. We had lots of beautiful hotels. We had a Main Street USA that looked like Disney World. We had television studios. We had the upper room that we copied from Jerusalem.
Was it like you get on a resurrection roller coaster and so you die, be born?
No, we didn't. We didn't have rides per se. We did have a huge water park, which was wonderful.
Because I was picturing like you guys got on a crucifix and
around. No.
That's what people picture.
No.
Oh, okay.
We're very normal people, believe it or not.
You don't go on camel rides from the
needle.
No,
but we did have camels there. We did the. We did the story of Christ, and we had camels, and we had sheep, and we had all the things that went along with the story of the crucifixion of Jesus. We had it all there in a big amphitheater. We had people actually say, if I died here, I would be happy. And we had several people that did die there and died happy, being where they wanted to be, which I thought was wonderful.
So it was sort of like heaven on earth.
It really was. It was almost too good. Yeah.
So you're the husband.
Yes.
This is. I don't have to kiss him. You're the second husband.
Yes.
The next. Well,
yes.
The man behind Jim Bakker.
That's right.
Hopefully, a little more kosher. You know, it's kind of interesting because you're so perky now. You know that. I mean, people want to know. You know that
there were valleys.
That there were valleys.
Deep valleys. I would sit in a closet sometimes, and I would close the door because it was the only place I could go where my children wouldn't hear, and I would cry so hard that my little dog that I used to have would run and hide under the clothes because I would cry so hard, asking God, why did this happen? And I went through about 4 years of real torture after we lost PT. I mean, terrible, terrible torture. But thank God there is a way out, no matter how bad your life may be. There is a way out of the hurt, always.
But besides Jesus, then Betty Ford helped you too.
I'll tell you what, I got on a little pill, and this was long before. This was, I got on a little pill called Ativan.
I know Ativan.
I was afraid to fly. So I took Ativan, and that helped me to fly.
Right.
And literally
no
fly.
No offense, Jesus.
No.
It was better.
I had to have a little help.
It was better.
What the pill did for me, it was calm down my insides that were jumping so bad. You understand
so
that?
So you're an addict, is what
and
you're
so
saying.
And so you become an addict. I would rather face life
I'd love
life
to see you on drugs, Tammy,
cold.
Because without drugs, you are a frightening woman. You still like do your own booze and stuff, you know, clean the toilet.
Oh, yeah, I do all the time.
No.
I sure do.
I don't believe
I
you.
I do. I clean all my own commodes. I wash all my... I have a dishwasher, of course. But I mean, I
want
I do
to
my,
see you cleaning your bathroom.
I do all
Let's
my
go
own,
wash the bathroom now.
I do all my
Get in the bathroom
enough.
Now.
I do all my own housework.
Oh, yep.
Now, everybody knows the tub has to be cleaned, right?
Yeah.
So,
water on our...
Tammy, you're in your stocking.
And we get some good cleaning, which I don't have my cleaning stuff here.
We'll get the cleaning
stuff. But I'll tell you, I'm a good cleaner, let me tell you.
You are fantastic.
I'm a good cleaner.
Look at this down go. Money hasn't spoiled this.
I'm fast. Do you faster like, than the speed of lightning.
You know, it's amazing how you could run this kind of empire and still have time to clean a bathtub. It's an amazing, you're an amazing woman, Tammy Faye.
Oh, Ruby, thank you. You're the first woman who's ever told me that.
No. And you clean a mean tub.
I clean a mean tub. I'll tell you, this tub, you'll give me an eat out of it when I'm finished.
No, I won't be eating out of it, Tammy, today.
Maybe you don't want Jell-O or anything like that.
No,
in the
nothing.
Tub. Okay.
But you know, it's, you know, all this stuff that happens to you, you just, well, I don't know what it is. I mean, you either are nuts. or I don't know, you're blessed with something.
Ruby likes an attitude, and as much as we would like to, many times you can't change what is happening in your life. But if you change your attitude about what is happening in your life, then that will bring true happiness. And so I take a bad situation, and I just change my attitude about it, and I decide I'm going to make it work for me.
Right.
And so that's basically what I do. It's an attitude change. A friend of mine wrote a little song that I really like, and it's called If Life Hands You a Lemon, Start Making Lemonade. And I think that's probably it in a nutshell. If life hands you a lemon, you know, make lemonade, throw in some sugar.
This
works
is a
every
song
time.
Of this?
Yeah, it is a song. Yeah, it's one of the songs I do.
See, after you hit that Diet Coke, you hit the we'll hit that button now. We got the orchestra in the toilet, haven't we?
Oh,
come
no.
Tammy, sing.
No.
Come on, sing out, Louise.
Sing out, Louise. Who's Louise?
Give us the song.
If life hands you a lemon, you start making lemonade. If the heat of the day gets a little too hot, you just start thinking shade.
No, Tammy.
You thank God for the situation, and you praise him for the day he made.
Yeah.
Oh, if life hands you a lemon,
up,
Ruby, start making
stand
lemonade. You know, we all get sidetracked just in making those plans of what we want to be and do. And you know, all too often, we don't even consult God
about what he has in mind for me and you.
Well, we plot and we scheme and we struggle and we fret. Then we're amazed when we're pruned by God's blade. You know what he's trying to tell us is that when life hands us a lemon,
turn that lemon into lemonade. When life hands you a lemon, oh, you start making lemonade.
Everybody, come on, come on,
when the heat of the day gets a little too hot, you just start thinking shade. You thank God for the situation, and you praise him for the day he made.
A little more sugar, and I like it a little sweeter. What about you?
How about
it's
you? Adorable. You could eat this woman up.
Dr. Terror, and I to my carnival of love.
Express to the Vault of Horror. Tonight, in a development which may prove confusing to slower followers, we're presenting Dr. Terror's House of Horrors, which features Peter Cushing as the other Dr. Terror, and takes place not in a House of Horrors, but a suburban railway compartment of horrors. Now, once you've got over the shock of seeing the great Cushing as an unshaven old git in fingerless gloves, assuming my nom de terreur, There's plenty to enjoy in this British portmanteau film with its once-in-a-lifetime cast. Dear old Peter Cushing and grumpy old Christopher Lee are present, as expected, as is Michael Goff in another of his No One Will Ever Know I Made This roles. But how many horror films give you the chance to see disc jockey-tastic Alan Fluff Freeman eaten by a super-intelligent clinging vine and future Hollywood superstar Donald Sutherland married to a vampire? Now, though it's about a train, this one seems to have been thrown together on a more bus-like principle. If you don't like this story, there'll be another one along in a minute. Thus, if the werewolf anecdote isn't to your liking, keep watching for the crawling hand sequence. All right, nod off.